Good morning and a very warm welcome to our service of worship again this morning. Thank you so much for joining, and I pray that wherever you are and whatever kind of week you may have had, you can have some space now to pause and stop in God's presence as we worship him together. Today we begin a fresh series in looking at and exploring Paul's letter to the Ephesians, and we'll be looking today in terms of an introduction to the letter, an overview and introduction together. Can I also let you know about next Sunday, the 1st of November, when we will celebrate communion again? And that would have been the final communion at Cockpen Carrington that Sunday, and so we'll all celebrate communion again together at the end of the service next week. That will be the same as on the two previous occasions when we've had communion together. So if you can have some bread and wine or juice ready at the start of the service, then you'll be ready to participate, so celebrate communion when we come to that part of the service. Coming back to this morning though, we come to our call to worship together today. And if you would like to, please do join in the words now of Psalm 145, some of the words from that psalm, if you would like to join in the words on the screen together. I lift you high in praise, my God, O my King, and I'll bless your name into eternity. God is all mercy and grace, not quick to anger, is rich in love. God is good to one and all. Everything he does is suffused with grace. Creation and creatures applaud you, God. Your holy people bless you. My mouth is filled with God's praise. Let everything living bless him. Bless his holy name from now to eternity. And so we come now to join together and sing to God's praise in our opening hymn today, which is number 715, Behold the Mountain of the Lord.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, before whom the book of history is laid, and who sees every event, knows every character, experiences every moment, compared to you, we are but a dandelion clock blowing in the wind, or a speck of dust caught in the sunlight. For we exist only in the moment, what we call the present, a gift from you. We cannot return to yesterday and correct our errors. We cannot venture into tomorrow and discover what lies ahead. Now is all we have. We are a limited people, confined, restricted. And yet from beyond time and all the stars, you reach out to us in love, to embrace us, to enfold us, and to make us welcome. And we rejoice and give you thanks for your mercy and your grace. God of mercy, whose heart is full of forgiveness and who does not deal with us as we deserve. When we have thought of ourselves more highly than we ought and forgotten to put our relationship with you first, may you forgive us, we pray. When we have loved only those who love us and ignored or turned aside from those who need a smile, may you forgive us, we pray. When we have acted as if all tomorrow was ours, yet neglected to do good in the moment of this day, may you forgive us, we pray. May Christ Jesus, who healed the sick, gave sight to the blind, and loosened the tongues of the dumb, free us from our faults and all that would hold us back from being the children that the eternal and loving God desires. May you lead us, Holy Spirit, in our worship now, opening our ears to listen, opening our hearts to praise, opening our wills humbly to respond. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And I'm very grateful now to Ross Lyle, who brings us our reading today.
Today's reading is taken from Ephesians chapter 1, verse 1 to 14. And this is taken from the New International Version. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 1 to 14. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, God's holy people in Ephesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. He chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and understanding, he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ, to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfilment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to put our hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance under the redemption of those who are in God's possession to the praise of his glory.
We come now, as I mentioned at the start, to begin an exploration of Paul's letter to the Ephesians. And I must admit to coming to this letter with some trepidation, because there is a fear of not being able to do justice to all that Paul wrote there, particularly in the opening chapter. Whenever you come to prepare a sermon or a reflection, there is always a sense of responsibility, a desire to handle the Word of God correctly and faithfully, to unfold all that it said to its readers in its day and all that it has to say to us today. But there are some passages like the opening section of Ephesians that have so much bursting out of them that you are filled with an added trepidation and really do want to be able to let them speak and sing with all the wonder and truth that Paul packed into them. Before we go too much further into the letter, we'll take some moments to have a look at the overview and introduction to the letter to set something of its scene. We can perhaps put on our Miss Marple or Hercule Poirot hat and do a little bit of background investigation into the letter and see what we can find out that will be helpful for us to know and to understand of its time and its setting. And one of the first questions that we can ask, in fact, is this letter actually written to the church in Ephesus? Well, you might say that's a very good start to be approaching Paul's letter to the Ephesians and to begin with the question, was it actually written to them or not? Why might we think the letter wasn't specifically written to the church in Ephesus? Sometimes when we are exploring one part of the Bible, we can use another part to help us throw further light on the actual part we're studying. And that is true of Ephesians. If we take a look in the book of Acts, we will find reference there to Paul's visits to Ephesus, briefly in chapter 18, but more particularly in chapters 19 and 20. We haven't had time to look at those today together, but you might want to do that afterwards and having a little read of those chapters. But what we glean from these chapters in Acts is that altogether, Paul spent about 3 years with the believers in Ephesus. The longest stay, in fact, in one missionary location that Luke records about Paul's journeys. And it was quite a small group of believers at the start, just 12. And so Paul would have got to know them quite well. And we read too that they became very fond of Paul. We learn that when he came to say goodbye to them for the last time, that they were in tears because Paul said to them that he would never see them again. And so because we know from Acts that Paul spent this long time at Ephesus, there are things that we might expect to find in the letter which we actually don't. As in some of other letters that Paul wrote, we might expect to find personal greetings to those he knew. And we might also expect more specific issues to be dealt with in the letter. But we don't find that at all. And what we do find instead is that in verses like chapter 1, verse 15, Paul suggests that he was writing to those that he didn't know. He says there, "Ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus," he's heard about their faith, but that suggests he hasn't met them yet in person. And that would be curious, wouldn't it, if this letter is specifically to the believers in Ephesus, that he suggests there that he hasn't met them, he's just heard about them. So what might be an answer to that dilemma? Well, what seems to be one possible answer is that the letter we now call the letter to the Ephesians was written originally as a circular letter that Paul prepared for quite a number of churches through the missionary area in which he had worked. Churches that he hadn't had a chance to visit himself, but he still wanted to encourage the flocks of believers who were there. In the opening greeting, we read that he says, "To the saints in Ephesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus." And some early manuscripts of this letter don't have the words "in Ephesus" there. And so it is a distinct possibility that this letter was meant originally as a circular letter to many churches at first, but became associated with the church at Ephesus when those words were later added in. I wonder if you have ever visited Ephesus. Sadly, I missed out on a visit there when I was in Turkey last summer, but I do hope perhaps someday to be able to get back and to be able to visit the ancient ruins of the city. In Paul's day, Ephesus was the most important city in Western Asia Minor, now Turkey. And it was a busy commercial centre at the intersection of major trade routes and had a populace of about 300,000 inhabitants. It was also a destination that people flocked to in order to see the vast temple of Artemis, the goddess Artemis in Greek culture, or Diana in the Roman world, both known as the goddess of fertility. And her temple in Ephesus was one of the seven wonders of the world, four times larger than the Parthenon in Athens. Investigating in Acts again, we discovered that there was a huge trade for silversmiths and craftsmen in the city, linked to the worship of Artemis at the temple. They made pots and pots of money, selling small silver shrines or coins for pilgrims and tourists to buy on their visits. And we learned too that Paul and his companions became the focus of a huge riot started by one of the silversmiths called Demetrius. Paul was preaching that man-made gods were no gods at all, and that there was only one true God, the Creator God, and only one means of salvation through faith in his Son, Jesus Christ. Demetrius was incensed and persuaded a crowd of the craftsmen to protest against Paul because he was discrediting Artemis and the temple, and perhaps more fundamentally for them, he was also severely threatening their future business by doing that. So Ephesus was a tricky place to be for Christians. It was a place of opportunity, which is possibly why Paul spent so much time there. We're told again in Acts 19 that when he experienced opposition from the members of the synagogue, he left there and went instead to the lecture hall of Tyrannus in the city, accompanied by the Ephesian disciples. And each day then, over the space of 2 years, Paul held discussions in the lecture hall about the kingdom of God, so that Jews and Greeks alike who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of God being taught as they came and went from the city. So there were great opportunities to share the gospel in Ephesus, and yet we can begin to see that Ephesus was quite a challenging place for Christians to be as well. They were living in a culture in Ephesus where the general populace were willing to tolerate just about anything other than the claims of Christ and those who upheld those claims. In addition to the following of Artemis and an associated permissive morality, Luke tells us in Acts as well that the forces of darkness were real in Ephesus. There was a practice of sorcery as well as the occult. And so with all of that, it would have been so easy for the small band of believers in Ephesus to feel completely overwhelmed. Like many other churches across Paul's missionary area, they could do with some real encouragement. And that's what Paul sought to provide in this wonderful letter. And we'll have a look further at that in a moment, but we're going to sing again now. And our hymn is number 536, May the Mind of Christ My Saviour. Remember the days of writing letters to each other. It's possibly become something of a rather lost art in our age and era now of mobile phones and texts and emails. Perhaps one of the last vestiges is the thank you letter, although even with that, quite often now it's rare perhaps to get a personal handwritten letter in favour often more now of a printed copy and the use of cut and paste for much of the body of the letter. I still do have memories of writing letters home once I'd left to go to university and then to work in London. And most often they were written on occasions when there was some exciting news to send back home. And so they were quite easy to write when one had so much that one wanted to put down on the page and share with folks back home. And we get a sense in Paul's opening verses of this letter we're looking at that he is writing passionately and he can't stop. In the Greek, verses 3 to 14 of the passage we read are all one sentence. There's no punctuation. Paul doesn't come up for air, he just writes and writes and writes, pouring out his thoughts on the page. The opening section is something like a doxology. It's come to be known as a symphony of salvation, proclaiming all God has done for us in Christ. And within Paul's urgency in writing, there is also a huge poignancy. He wrote in around AD 60 while imprisoned in Rome. And Paul seems to have had a sense at that stage that his execution is now just around the corner. This letter is then his final communication to the early churches and to us. And because of that, it becomes something of a rather timeless letter. In those closing moments of his life and ministry, what is it that he wants to impart to the church at Ephesus and to the other young churches he'd never managed to visit, but had heard about and wants to encourage? We'll find that its message is filled with assurance of God's grace, of encouragement and sound guidance for pursuing the Christian life. It's a lasting, powerful message, not only for the young churches in Paul's day, but for Christians in all times and places. What we'll discover is that Paul will take three whole chapters to highlight and celebrate all that God has done for us in Christ. Three chapters to explain the wonders of God's grace. God's grace is unmerited favour upon us, and it's outworking in his plans for salvation. Only then does he turn in chapters 4 to 6 to look at what life should look like for those who are called to be Christ's faithful followers. And that's how Paul refers to his readers in his opening words of greeting. He says, "To the saints in Ephesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ." The word saint here might be confusing. We might mix it up with the great Catholic saints who are each venerated for their holy lives and for the miracles they performed. But in the New Testament context, all believers are called saints because they are set apart, each one, to belong to God and called to live upright lives in faithful obedience to him. We are each one saints. And Paul offers them a word of encouragement in his opening words, because wherever they are, whether in Ephesus or in any of the other locations to which the letter went, they are also in Christ Jesus. In Ephesus, but also in Christ Jesus. As we have seen, the believers in Ephesus faced opposition and discouragements of many kinds that could have been overwhelming for them. But here Paul straight away reminds them all that they are also in Christ. They belong to Christ through their faith in him, and he is far greater than all the other forces that might come against them. And Paul prays grace and peace to them from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And these two ideas of grace and peace weave constantly through this letter. And that's because the assurance of the gospel for Paul is that God grants peace through grace. God grants peace through grace. As we have seen, grace is God's unmerited favour, his unmerited love to us. As we're reminded in 1 John 4 and verse 10, this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. The source of love and salvation is God. And being awakened to that love and being led to put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, who died to take away our sins, we receive a restored oneness in our relationship with God. We are reconciled with God in Christ, and our hearts know a new peace, being released from any former sense of fear and condemnation before God. And as well as peace with God, we also find growing peace with each other. When we grasp the vastness of God's love for us, we become open to the changing work of the Holy Spirit within us. Bit by bit, we respond in learning to be at peace more and more with those around us. Receiving God's grace leads us to peace with him and peace with each other in deepening measure as we trust in him and give our hearts to him. That's probably enough for today, and we'll return to these thoughts as we look further into Paul's letter in the weeks ahead. But today now, we're going to join in prayers, our prayers of thanksgiving and prayers for others and ourselves. And I'm grateful to Ian B, who will lead us in those now.
Loving God, we thank you for the person that Paul was, with such a passion to serve you and proclaim you with all his energy and heart. Thank you for the wonderful words and insights he set down, helping us in each generation to grasp more and more of who you are and of your amazing purpose to save all who are lost. We wonder at the unmerited favour you lavished on us, so powerfully expressed in the cross of Christ and in his resurrection. Through him we know peace with you and peace with each other. We discover life as you intended it to be, and a sureness of hope for today and tomorrow. As we think of Paul in prison for his faith, we pray for those in the same place today and those who are persecuted for their faith. May they have a strong sense of your presence, and may their courage and selfless love bring a change of heart and faith to those around them. We pray for others wrongly imprisoned because they stood up for what is right and just. We pray for those who seek asylum and refuge from their past and who now live in detention centres. We pray for those whose helplessness condemns them to a form of slave labour. For those working unbearably long hours with little or no pay. For the increasing number of people who are trafficked, seeking a better future and yet trapped by the cruelty and greed of others. We pray for those who long to be free. We remember those who are in prison for what they've done. We thank you for those who look after them and work with them to find a better path in life. Officers, teachers, counsellors, chaplains. So much of what goes wrong in our lives stems from a lack of love. May those in prison come to discover you know and love them, and so find spiritual healing and freedom. We pray for others who long to be free, for those who know daily pain and who are overwhelmed with the struggle of coping, for those with a diagnosis that leaves them imprisoned in fear, for those whose health curtails a freedom they used to know. We pray for those who are trapped by the snares of self-contempt, for those who disregard their own inherent worth and loveliness, those locked in anxiety and fear, those enveloped in the darkness of depression without any sense of light at the end of the tunnel, those who wish to be free of the pain of this life. We pray for those who long to be free, for those who cannot break free from poverty and hunger, for those facing recurring drought and floods. In the midst of COVID-19, we would all long to be set free from its impact affecting us in so many different ways, with loneliness, separation, uncertainty, stress and fear, loss of work, loss of income, loss of loved ones without being able to say goodbye, loss of hope. God, Father, Son and Spirit, you are the God who loves freely, the God whose love is unconditional and infinite. May you bring your comfort, healing and strength to all who sit in need, and may hope be rekindled in the assurance of your love with us eternally. All this we pray in the name of Jesus, your dear Son. Amen.
We've thought about grace and peace today as we've started to look at the letter of Ephesians. And in our final hymn today, we also think about responding to God's grace and finding his peace, as we join in hymn 465, Dear Lord and Father of Mankind.
Thank you.
My very grateful thanks to those who have taken part in this service today and for those who have helped prepare it, and also to you for joining. Thank you so much for being with us. As we close today, wherever we are, may we take this moment to speak words of blessing over each other as we join to say the words of the grace today and as we head out into the week ahead. We say these words of blessing. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and evermore. Amen.